Oh, the rock stars of Fox Footy there with the longest kick. This is grand final day on Fox with thanks to the Ford Ranger. A big welcome to the chief of the longest kick, Jason Dunstall, and also one of the team captains, Jack Riewoldt. Guys, that looked like a whole lot of fun and some guys whose reputations are a little damaged after that.
It was, Sarah. Good afternoon to you. Good afternoon to everyone. We had a lot of fun, Jack. It was a long day.
It was a long day, Chief.
The boys spent most of their time just snipping at each other, didn't they?
Yeah, no, we were very lucky that Andrew Gaze is there. He's a very, very funny man. And we got to relive the fact that Jordan Lewis let Team Blue down again up in the green room. Had everyone laughing at him, so
wouldn't
second
break
comrade.
40 metres.
And he goes, oh, I can kick a drop punt 60.
Oh, please.
Come on, Geordie. Come on. You let me down.
Well, the winner, four-time premiership star with the Hawks, first ever win in this very special and prestigious award, and perhaps the best dressed man there, Jared Ruff.
Oh, look at him!
Ruff, is that a genuine Gucci ensemble?
When you're good, you're good.
Talk us through the outfit, Ruff. Where did you get it, and how much is that worth? I mean, Gucci doesn't come cheap.
Oh, look. I'll leave it up to my stylist. It's fair to say I've got some people in high places, so a couple of special friends live close by the area. So, look, if we can share for the runway, we share.
He's good, the boy, isn't he?
Oh, God.
He's got the swagger.
What I love, Jack, is he doesn't say more than he needs to, does he?
He's got a bit of Heisenberg about him too right now from Breaking Bad a little bit, Ruffy.
So we're just having a look at your kick here, Ruff. Talk us through it. Were you confident? Because most people I've spoken to during the week just assumed that Jack, being the current day star, would win this. But the old fella showed that you've still got it.
Thanks, Ez. I was a little bit nervous in the warm-up seeing Jack, who had the one boot on, who was pretty confident. But I guess, you know, when you're now a part-time assistant coach trying to kick the ball out to players now, all you have to do is just kick. So I had the form.
All right, we're having a look at Jack's kick now. Jack, were you concerned that you'd injure yourself? What did Dimmer think of you participating in this? Don't want to blow a hammy right now, do you?
No, I haven't spoken to Dimmer since the toe poke goal to draw against the Hawks in that last round, so he didn't know about it. But I was confident, but Ruffy was the only person that that I thought might beat me due to the fact that he's at Clubland. To be honest, just wrapped to beat Rui.
I thought the stage was set for some classic Jack Riewoldt magic, because if he had have kicked what he needed to, he would have snipped Ruffy in the individual and dragged his team over the line. We kind of thought he likes the big stage. I'm thinking big barrel. Just couldn't get it done.
It was nearly like it was manipulated, Chief. It was so perfect.
You'd think that, wouldn't you?
No, it was so perfect.
One of the best moments for mine was Jonathan Brown, who's limping around Fox Footy's offices at the moment. A bit of a toe-stubbing incident there, and the divot that came out of that grass was quite epic.
What we couldn't work out, Jack, is how he made two divots.
No.
Matching divots on left and right foot.
Yes, no, well, unfortunately the cameras weren't rolling, Chief, because Big Brownie, he's got a lot of pride, Brownie, and he thought, I'll have a bit of a practice kick in between shooting the two rounds. And he actually did it again. So we did it twice. We didn't catch the second one on air, but no, just another Team Blue member that unfortunately failed under pressure.
There were a couple of egos there that were dented slightly, weren't they? Brownie and Rui, I'm suggesting, just weren't happy with where they ended up.
No, they were pretty keen to get out of there once their kicks were done. I said to Louis, because they're both very impatient, especially Nick, he's extremely impatient. And I said to Louis, I said, watch, Rui will finish his kick here and he'll ask to leave. And sure enough, gets his kick out, 51 metres, good try, but straight away goes, Brownie, we pack our bags up and leave. Didn't want to hang around to the end, so no. But Ruffy, I mean, what a great kick.
Yeah, and, great effort.
It was good fun. Obviously doing a bit different now with COVID these days, so it was a great challenge.
Ruffy, we're going to let you go, but first we need to get your tip. And has your lovely wife Sarah told you that there is no way that trophy's coming inside your beautiful house?
Well, if I mean, for me, my kids, this is all they think I've won. So before... You know, before they were born, I've won a couple of other things, but they think that this is the number one thing in the house that Dad was good at. So it might have to stay here. But tonight, I mean, all week I was thinking the D's. I've swung a little bit to the Dogs, but, I mean, the last 5 years I've picked the loser, so there's no point asking me.
Well, Ruff, we loved your work in the longest kick, and that trophy is hideous. Go and hide it somewhere, I think.
Straight to the dip.
Beautiful.
The good news is that's one of the trophies you don't mind if the kids trash it. You don't lose anything, do you?
That hasn't made it inside the house.
No.
Well, Ruffy's on his front porch. I'd be going to my neighbour's house and just getting a video in front of that, but it certainly hasn't made it inside, I don't reckon.
It is such a great part of the tradition right here on Fox Footy on Grand Final Day. We're going to take a really close look at tonight's game shortly. And every year there is a story that really tugs on our heartstrings. And this year it has been the journey of Nathan Jones, who's been at the D's through their darkest hours, their toughest times, and unfortunately won't be playing tonight. But he's had a pretty joyous couple of weeks with the arrival of two new babies to the Jones clan. So we're going to catch up with him shortly.
The situation has been really tough, you know, personally for myself and for the coaches because of what Nathan means to the Melbourne Footy Club.
To endure what he has endured at the football club, my first year we were getting, you know, booed and off the field and, you know, scarves thrown at us, memberships thrown at us. To him to experience that year after year, to continue to stay with the football club, continue to invest in the people at the football club, you know, show players the level of professionalism, the mindset, the attitude needed. It's been, you know, such a pleasure to work with and thankful that I was able to experience with Nathan.
Yeah, what, 16 years into the football club. He's been here for a massive, massive shift in our culture and how we play and how we act off the field and on the field.
To see that how much he's put in the singular goal of being a part of a successful team over the last 2-3 years in particular has been inspiring and incredible. If he's not a part of this group, I don't think we're here today.
I would have loved to have been a fairy tale for Nathan to be involved in this moment, but it's not to be, and footy's a cruel game.
This is a real tough one because my first day at the club, Jonesy picked me up and has looked after me like an older brother. And hopefully he can get a heap of joy out of watching us play. I know he really is invested in the group.
He's given the club so much over 16 years. He's seen a club go through some really tough times to a club now where he walks away leaving a legacy of something that he's really proud of.
I think he's going to leave like a legacy on the football club. It's going to be everlasting.
And what a legacy it has been. If the D's are to win tonight, this man here, Nathan Jones, has played such a big role in it. Congratulations on the new additions to the family, little Dove and little Odie. How is home life at the moment? No doubt you're pretty tired.
Yes, I was about to say, I haven't had a lot of sleep, but my wife and I are hanging in there. We've got a fair bit of help around home and four kids is a fair jump, obviously, from 2 to 4. But, no, we're feeling good. It's been obviously a great week. We've had a week at home, week in hospital and settling in pretty nicely.
Such an emotional roller coaster for you. The lows and the disappointment, I suppose, of missing out, and then the absolute high of these beautiful little bubbas joining your family.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a silver lining, really. Obviously, there's an element of, you know, personal disappointment from an individual sort of player perspective, but ultimately, you know, I'm absolutely wrapped for the team and I'm excited to watch the game tonight. I've spoken to plenty of the boys in the last day or two and they're all feeling pretty confident and ready to go, and yeah, it should be good fun.
So now that the day's actually arrived and you're here on Grand Final Day, how are the emotions inside you?
I'd be lying if it still isn't bubbling away, but yep. I'm just doing my best to sort of control those. I got up this morning, obviously helped around the house, and off I went for a run for an hour just to try and I guess control some of that sort of inner turmoil, but. Yep. As I said, coupled with that is just reaching out and touching base with the boys over there. It's the hardest thing probably right now is that disconnect, the fact that I've left and I'm not even a part of that build-up. Yep. So I think hearing their excitement and, you know, their nerves and just talking to them about the week and, you know, I think that's sort of, that's rubbed off on me and, you know, I'm feeling good. I'm pretty excited, as I said, and looking forward to the opportunity that presents itself for those boys and hopefully we can get the job done for the bigger picture of the club and its supporter base who have been through a really difficult time. Mm.
Have you had any contact in terms of with the coaches about possibly doing something over or even done something over the last period to still remain a part of it? Because you are the ex-captain of the football club, 300 games, you've had a hell of a career. Is there anything that they've reached out and said, can you do a little video for the boys? Or have you even got involved in this demon WhatsApp group?
Well, I'm in the WhatsApp, obviously, so it's I'm sort of hearing what's going on here and there. But, you know, I by circumstance, just having to leave Perth pretty early, I had to ended up retiring via Zoom. So a lot of boys have sort of reached out since then and we've sort of touched base and a lot of them sort of commended me on how I spoke and stuff, and said how much they've sort of loved playing with me and those kind of things. So it was really nice from a personal point of view to hear that and the sort of impact and influence that I've had on them. And as I said, the best thing for me is just sort of let that go and not be a distraction for them. And I touched base yesterday just to wish them all good luck. And there's not too much I can do, to be honest, from here. It's I think they're prepared and ready, and they sort of know what's coming. I'm sure they're going to be ready to put their best foot forward tonight.
It's funny because at times I think we define people's success by premierships, and that's no fault of the player, because it's, are you in the right place at the right time, at the right club, when they're going through that? But when you look back at your career, you must be thrilled with what you've been able to achieve personally. I mean, it's been a fantastic contribution.
Yeah, I think, there's no doubting throughout my career I grappled with that through the difficult times. I wouldn't have scripted my career as far as sort of individual accolades and team accolades to go the way it did. But in saying that, the reflection that I've had over the last probably 10 or 12 days and the amount of messages of support from not only our supporters but teammates and ex-players and that kind of thing, I think it's the influence that I've had on people around me, which in the end, maybe that means more to me, what I mean? I think you want to leave the club. I wanted to always win a premiership at the club, but my number one thing was to leave the club in a better position. And for those younger guys to not have an experience that I had, and for the club to have, restored its, I guess, its famed history and be in a position to challenge. And, as much as it's disappointing to not be playing today, what better position can the club be in, really, other than to win tonight?
Do you think, Jonesy, the boys understand how big this is, being away from home and not actually getting to experience, Melbourne, the town, as it is through this finals period and this grand final period? I mean, every second door's got the Melbourne jumper painted on it. It's even just driving through the suburbs today, you can just see red and blue balloons everywhere. Are you disappointed that they're not getting to experience that? And have you relayed it back to them that it is literally, the town is blue and red and there's a little bit of white over the western suburbs?
That's sort of one thing I said to them. It's like, I guess the disappointing thing out of all of it is the fact that this game isn't in Melbourne. Like, it'd be 10 times what it is in Perth. Mm. But in saying that, what they're experiencing over there, the boys were just, they don't know any different, haven't experienced what Melbourne's like. So they're embracing what they're, the opportunity they've got right now. And the excitement, as I said before, in their voices about, yesterday's captain's run, I think there's 20,000 people over there. And I think in a way it may be an advantage for us, the fact that you are sort of half shielded from all of the distractions that would be in Melbourne. I said that to a few guys before, over in the it didn't feel like we were going into a prelim, like we're sort of secluded in the Joondalup Resort. We're relaxed and just doing our own thing. And it's not till you arrive at Optus Stadium that you realise, hang on, we're actually here for an AFL final. And I think that build up, albeit there would have been a few extra things this week, wouldn't be too different. And I think that will bode well for our group. And, as I said before, they'll be ready to go.
I've got to sneak in with one, Jonesy. I want to ask you a really tough question. I know your heart and soul is all about the D's and you would love nothing more than to see your teammates win today. If Melbourne were to lose, would that be an easier pill for you to swallow, do you think, rather than missing out on playing in a premiership?
I don't think so, to be honest, because the love and, I guess, connection that I have with the playing group, as much as it's a bitter pill for me to swallow individually, I think the selflessness of our entire footy club has been around team for so long now to build us to this position. It would be, I couldn't see myself feeling that way. The only way for me to reflect on it is to have my own individual pain, but separate that, which I've done, and be completely immersed in, where the club's at and the opportunity that they have at hand. And, from my heart of hearts, I hope they absolutely win tonight.
And you'll win a lot of admiration for having that attitude. You've come back to be with your family. Obviously, there's wives and partners and little kids that are donning the red and blue at home today and trying to stay up late to watch Dad. We've got some beautiful pictures there of the McDonald family. So, it's tough on the families. These are little kids that they're leaving behind. But listening to Max Gawn and his conversation with Gary Lyon the other day, it was all business. The guys know that they're there to do a job and they'll catch up with family and friends when they get back. But there's quite a ruthless mentality to the group.
Yeah, 100%. I think the difference between this year hubbing versus last year is there's a real end point. Like, we go away in a final series knowing that, we could be here for 2 weeks, we could be here for 4 weeks, but the carrot on the end of that is obviously quite significant. And we've been lucky enough to, tick all the boxes and be in the position we're in. So I think it can sit more comfortably with guys, the fact that they're making that sacrifice to be away from family and friends and their children. So I know those boys, a few of them I spoke to yesterday that are dads, you know, they struggle with that time away, but they know the bigger picture in all of it and the opportunity they have at hand. And I think they've been able to separate that and focus on, you know, what they've got ahead of them.
Both such great stories. We've got Melbourne with the 57-year drought and then the Western Bulldogs aiming to win their third flag in 5 years, and they had the drought breaker back in 2016. Jack, can you see parallels between where Richmond were at in 2017 and perhaps where the D's are at this time? Just that huge, huge fan base desperately clinging to just some success after some really, really hard times.
Well, you're right, Sarah. I see massive parallels between where our football club was in 2017, just the way even we play. A very similar defensive first mindset. Even positional players, you look at Jake Lever plays a lot like Nick Vlosten, Stephen May plays a lot like Alex Rant. So you just sort of start to piece the puzzle there. And I'm in my heart of hearts, and I've said this before, I've never supported the Melbourne Football Club and have had a fair few tussles on the ground a couple of times, and words have been exchanged between me and Jonesy on the ground. But I really want this football club to win this premiership for the fact that it connects generations. And for the Richmond faithful, they were obviously a successful football club. 1980 was the last premiership before 2017. And there's a whole generation of fans that were born in the 1970s that became Richmond people, and then they had kids and they made them become Richmond people, and they didn't get that success, so they'd sort of hated their mum or dad. Like, why did you make me go for Richmond? Because we're the laughing stock. This is going to connect Melbourne families and Melbourne supporting families through generations, grandfathers, grandmothers, down to the next generation, right down to the newest generation that are coming through. And it is something that I look back on from 2017, and that is the thing that I'm most proud of, and probably brings the most joy to me, the fact that I was able to do that for people I'll never meet and never even know. So I really hope the Melbourne boys get that chance to do that. And the Doggies did it, 5 years ago, 6 years ago. So it's something very special.
1964 is such a long time ago. The current crop, are they
aware
of it?
Thank you, Jonesy. I was born in 1964.
Not that long, too.
Jonesy, the current group, you've thrown me there, Jonesy. The current group aware of the history and their place in history that they can construct now?
Yeah, I think that's one thing Goody's really good at, is drawing back on that. And, you know, this week I saw via, you know, some of the stuff on the Melbourne Instagram story, the fact that a lot of past players, whether that be premiership players like Hassan Mann from back in 64, or even current day greats of the past, like, you know, Nita and those kind of guys, reaching out and leaving a message of support. So I don't think, you know, the gravity of the opportunity won't be lost on the playing group, but at the same time, it'll be sort of that fine balance of not getting too sort of worried about that and letting that sort of dictate your, you know, the stress and pressure, and just focusing on, you know, what they can control. And I'm sure that they'll have that balance right. And as I said, you know, I have no doubt they'll be doing it for not only themselves but everyone else, but focused on just ticking it off a quarter at a time.
And then the curse of Norm Smith and the whole story that comes from that, Jase. I mean, listening to Mike Sheehan talk about
they
that
don't
time,
exist,
it's a fascinating history.
No, I don't believe in that sort of stuff. No, I think you make your own history as you're going along.
Good story, though.
But I love the fact that we've got a story on both sides of the coin. I mean, you speak about what it means to the Melbourne Football Club, and I think of all those long-suffering supporters. And in a way, it's almost, I know it's ironic that they won't be there to support it, but it's almost fitting that it's going to be that sort of journey, that they won't be there to crowd the MCG. They'll see it happen, but everyone will love it just the same. But for the Bulldogs, as you mentioned, if they pick up a couple of flags in 5 years, they become a power team and basically part of an era for them, instead of being a one-off wonder and then disappearing back into the night.
So even the journey into the finals and through the finals for the Bulldogs, we've never seen anything like this. Where they've travelled, what they've had to do quarantine-wise.
And they're trying to come from outside the top four again to win it, which would be amazing.
Yeah, they're the last team to do it, so it's going to be very exciting.
I hope someone from the Dogs has documented all this, because it'll make quite an interesting book about football in the times of COVID and what they've had to do with some of the protocols. Well, soaking up all the grand final atmosphere over there in Perth for us is Kath Lochman and also Matthew Pavlich. Guys, you're also soaking up the sun. It looks a stunning day over there.
Yeah, we're so lucky to be here. We're in a great spot. We've got all the AFL functions just to our rights. All the heavy hitters are starting to roll on in. I've got a heavy hitter alongside me, Matthew Pavlich. It's finally here. I mean, we've talked about it all week, the AFL Grand Final in Perth.
And isn't Perth absolutely pumped, Kath? Ooh, yeah. It is. It's thriving, it's pumping, it's frothing at the moment. In around the stadium, you can see the Matagara Bridge with people coming across to the stadium from East Perth. The precinct is on fire at the moment. There's people and energy starting to build, and you cannot get a ticket for love or money. We've said that a couple of times this week. The demand over here for this event has been through the roof, and Perth has completely embraced the grand final here today.
We've got the Canfield out the front there. Oh, yeah, you can even have a kayak if you want. I wonder if he's going to the game. But we've got the Canfield out the front as well, which is pumping. I mean, this is just the place to be today.
It is the place to be, and you're right about this spot. There's so much action happening. We've had some legends come past. You think about West Australian greats of the game. Ross Glendinning was just walking past before. Brian Peake, Graham Moss, John Todd, David Mundy as well, someone I know quite well. So a great spot to be where we are here, and great to have so many WA people represented here to come and watch the game. The game are outside here at the 19s, the next generation coming through as well. So lots of action on.
I was just about to say, how exciting for these young kids just behind us, the under-19s national championships. We've got WA v South Australia. These kids must be pinching themselves.
They must be. That's right. There's a few, I believe, that there's been a few that are missing this game because of Colts grand finals, both in the SNFL and Waffle, and obviously senior finals as well. But at three-quarter time, it's a pretty close one. WA just up, and what a great opportunity, as you said, to get that sense of what grand final day is about. These young talent, I'm sure, will be on display next year in the AFL.
So shortly we'll have 61,000 packed inside Optus Stadium. How many times have you been asked for tickets in the last few days?
Too many. I've turned the phone off. It's one of those ones where I'm out. I don't have any more. What about you? You must have got a few.
Yeah, a fair few. Had none to give away, so sorry, everyone. So what have we got? About 3 hours to go until the first bounce. Yeah. Take us inside the minds of the players, Pav. You've been there in 2013. What, they'll be on their way at the moment, on the bus probably?
Certainly the guys from Melbourne, given Joondalup laps about 45 minutes away from here. Yeah, they will probably be on the bus or starting their final preparations in terms of getting ready to get to the ground. It's a nerve-wracking time, but it's an exciting time. All the players talk about is trying to enjoy the moment, soak up the atmosphere when they first get here. Of course, it's a bit different. There's lots of pre-game entertainment. It's a ground they haven't played a huge amount of. But I think even just yesterday, seeing that training session, the captain's run for both teams, they were relaxed. They were enjoying themselves. They were very much soaking up. So trying to stay as calm as you can, but just starting to drop a few things in around what the message should be, or the preparation and the structures for once the bounce down actually eventuates.
At the same time, you could see on the players' faces yesterday it started to become real, didn't it, as they ran out and saw what there was only about 15,000 in the house yesterday. It's going to be 61 today. So it's getting there. It's building here, guys, but it's going to get a little bit more rowdy, I think, in the hours to come.
Looks like the two of you are doing it pretty tough. Kath looks like she's had a month on the beach, absolutely glowing. Pav's pockets are probably overflowing from all the functions he's done this week.
Very cool team.
I need to ask you, Pav, you speak about the colour and all the people that are lining up and the precincts are buzz. I imagine there's a lot of red and blue and there's a lot of dogs' colours as well. But what about the general just football sort of public in Western Australia? Have they embraced it as much as all those that might be barracking for one team or another?
Absolutely, Jace. I don't think anyone has... Everywhere you go, people have been talking about the game. Cafes, restaurants, school drop-offs. Like, seriously, everywhere you go, it's about the grand final and where you're watching and what you're going to do. Have you got a ticket? It's been the most relevant one. But my sense is the sentimental favourite is Melbourne. Yes. And right at this early stage, there does seem a bit more red and blue than the Bulldogs colours. But I can tell you that there is a lot of Bulldog supporters, old people coming out of the woodwork here in WA. I know lots of people have come across from Adelaide as well just to enjoy the day.
I think the Demons, the drought-breaking story is the popular story everyone's getting behind. I mean, speaking to CEO Gary Pert yesterday, and he said that they sold a year's worth of Melbourne merchandise in 2 days after the prelim final win. So I think Perth people were jumping right on board.
And they were the team that had the most support in the prelim here against Geelong a couple of weeks ago. So maybe Perth people jumping on the red and blue.
Yeah, I loved it. My brother the other day said, who are we going for, Geelong, Melbourne? And I said, let's go Melbourne. He goes, oh, all their scarves are sold out, so we're going Geelong. And look what that happened. So a lot of red and blue perhaps in the stadium tonight, guys.
And it is a beautiful stadium too, Kath. I understand during the week you got a bit of a different perspective. Now, we're going to have a look at some vision. Oh, no. I think you're insane because earlier in the year, we went onto the top of the MCG roof, and that was the most terrifying thing I've ever done in my life.
You didn't go too well that day, Jonesy, did you?
I did not. And then I've seen this vision of you. Talk us through this.
Well, they said, oh, you should lean back. And so I gave it a go. And my high heels were right on the edge. And the instructor actually said, oh, Kathy, you can go a little bit further back if you like. I was like, what, and die? Well, is that what we want?
There's your first error. Footwear. Footwear on grand final day is important.
Yes.
You're wearing high heels.
It's got to add a bit of class. a little bit frightening up the top, but it was amazing to get that view of Optus Stadium. Such a magnificent stadium. We're so lucky to be here.
And the light show, and it's going to come to life. There's so much great entertainment. WA-based talent, of course, but the light show and the excitement, I think, is going to be something like we've never seen before.
We've got Beds of Tokyo, Eskimo Joe,
John Butler Trio, Baker Boy. It's a pretty good lineup.
Yeah, talented people here in WA.
Amazing stadium, Kath. You are incredibly brave. I wouldn't have done that for $10 million, $50 million. No way.
$50 million.
All the money in the world.
I wouldn't have done for $50 million. $50 large.
Nude in heels.
Yeah, nude in heels for $50 million.
You haven't seen Jonesy with heights. Not good. Not good.
Because I would have fainted on the way up and not even made it there. Another man who's incredibly brave today is Tom Morris, a big Demons fan. And very nervous in the lead up. But Tom, what we need to know from you is the latest team's news, because how far out from the game are we going to sense of who the subs are? Has it leaked yet?
Yeah, not exactly 100% sure yet, Sarah, but we get a selection call from the Dogs in about, 2 hours' time, and we'll know where their sub is. They're going to determine whether it's Anthony Scott, Ryan Gardner. It won't be Ryan Gardner, actually. He was dropped on Wednesday night, and that was confirmed on Thursday. So he won't be the sub. And the other two are Lathan Vandermeer and Ed Richards. Now, there are unconfirmed reports this afternoon that it will be Richards. He's played just 5 games for the year, so I haven't confirmed that with the Dogs yet. We probably won't know till the Dogs actually release their team. Now, Alex Keith is fit and he's ready to play after missing the prelim final with a hamstring injury. Trained fully this week. Chris Grant told me a couple of weeks ago, their head of football, that he would have actually played in the prelim final had it been a grand final. Such was the tightness in the hamstring, not necessarily a bad one. Now, Steve May, he's fit and ready to go as well for Melbourne with a hamstring. And Charlie Spargo hurt his ankle last week, but he's trained fully all week as well. So, Sarah, really just Adam Tomlinson for Melbourne and Josh Bruce for the Dogs, missing from an injury perspective for both teams. They're both primed for this game tonight at Optus Stadium. It should be an absolute ripper and they're pretty much full strength.
Yeah, no excuses for either side. Thanks very much to Tom Morris in the newsroom. Well, the man shouldering the responsibility of leading the Demons into battle tonight is none other than their superstar skipper, Max Gawn, coming off the game of his career. He certainly is in red-hot form.
Max Gawn is a talisman of the Demons. The towering ruckman is their skipper and the face of his footy club. But it wasn't always like this.
I'll take it back to my first year. I was the only one without a number. And I still only got a number 3 weeks in. And then I sort of said, why am I got a number to Bales or someone like that? And he goes, Jim's working on getting 37 free, which was Warnock. Matthew Warnock got moved to number one, and then all of a sudden 37's free. So Jim was able to pull some strings to get me in 37.
Jim, of course, is Jim Steins, legendary Demons ruckman, who saw enough of himself and young Max to make sure he began his career in the same number he did.
He stood me up in front of me. It was the 6 draftees, Scully, Trengrove, great names within that draft, and all our parents, all our family and board members. And he stood me up in front, made me stand up, and everyone's looking at me and he goes, this kid's going to be different. And I'm like, why is he pinpointing me? Like, I don't feel like I'm different. I'm just one of these draftee kids. He goes, this kid's going to be different. And he got me afterwards and said, you know what I mean by that? He goes, you do it differently. Don't conform. Don't be that person who thinks he has to be someone else, because you'll waste your energy. You'll waste your energy trying to be someone else and I'll be out of the door in 2 years. Now, looking back on it, it's some of the best words I've ever been given, and I feel like it's my job now to tell that. It's okay to be different. You tick off these values, you tick off what we want you to do on the field and off the field, and then just go be the person you want to be, and that's Jim.
Max swapped his number 37 for 11, just like Jim did, but he's not trying to be anyone but himself.
Max Gawn pulls down a ripper. There it is again. Where do you want it?
Even if people want to be a little bit like him.
That's it. Mate, I'm growing a beard this week.
Why wouldn't you? He's a five-time All-Australian, two-time best and fairest, and maybe a premiership captain.
And Melbourne, a minor premier. Wow. Just like that.
He got them there with a signature performance in the prelim.
The skipper on the run, around the corner. They've got eight.
He was a force. A constant procession of highlights, a masterclass in match winning.
55 metres, set sail for home.
It's the best ruck performance I have ever seen.
Look at Gawn kicking goals, laying tackles.
I've never seen anyone do that.
I've always wanted to add more things to my game. I didn't think five goals was one thing I was adding to my game. I'll start with that.
Have a look at this, another one for the Demons. It's Max Gawn.
Max Gawn has gone from a numberless draftee to captaining the game's oldest club in a grand final. And he, like his team, has done a great job. But the job's not done.
I think people know, and deep down I know that people are happy either way, but I'm not. Nah, I really want to win this.
You're watching Grand Final Day on Fox pre-game, brought to you by Ford Ranger.
How much time do you put into Aaron Norton? Like, you know, he's going to be critical. We know that. You know that. The whole footy world knows it. It's not like it's one of those ones where he's going to sneak up on you. You know what he brings. So how much time you could put into him?
He's a very exciting, very, very talented footballer. I've played this probably be our fourth matchup this year now because we had a pre-season match. And he's a star. He launches at the footy. As you saw on the prelim last week, poor Trent McKenzie, I was watching. You know, some good mates of Trent, and I've seen him far out.
English Shacky Norton flies!
Seem to be a player that thrives on the big stage. Do you thrive against the big opponents too? Because Stephen May and yourself are being talked about a fair bit in the lead up to this grand final.
Yeah, it's something that I do enjoy, big games and going against the best. So, yeah, Stephen May's had an unbelievable year, so it'd be a good matchup.
The teeth of goal, Norton. Oh, and takes an absolute screamer.
He's a confidence player. He's someone you've got to be on from the get-go. You don't want him up early because he starts taking mark of the year and kicking goals. So he's definitely a tough matchup. All these new breed key forwards now are all similar. Like, they're lightning quick and they can jump and mark. So I have a big job, no doubt.
But that's an outstanding mark from Stephen May.
He's probably just their general down there. He likes to sort of set them all up. He's pretty talented. He's pretty physical, gifted athletically with his speed and strength. So, he's a pretty difficult matchup.
Welcome back to a grand final day on Fox Footy with thanks to the Ford Ranger. That matchup certainly looms as one of the more pivotal of tonight's grand final. Nathan Jones, how instrumental is Stephen May going to be in what happens this evening?
Oh, huge. Obviously, it's obviously him and Lever that are, hold together our back six, with their direction, making sure we get the depth and the coverage that we need. And that matchup's obviously going to be pivotal. I'd expect Steve to probably play on Norton. And it's interesting listening to Steve talk. He says that he's the hardest player he's played on in the comp this season. So, and you heard him just before in that grab mention how much he has to sort of get on top of him early because once he gets up and going, how pivotal he is to how well the Dogs go.
He's done well on him a couple of times this year, Jack, Stephen May. But if we watching Aaron Norton in the prelim final, if you can't stop his run and jump, and Steve May spoke about his athleticism and the speed of these players, if he's allowed to run and jump, he took 9 marks in the prelim. He can cut them up if he's allowed to run and jump at the footy.
He's got this ability to contort his body and protect the ball drop like no other, I think. In the air, we see those amazing chest marks. Yeah. How can he catch on his chest? But he actually has the ability to use his hips, shift his body in front, protect the drop zone. It's interesting that Joey Montagna put this on AFL 360 2 weeks ago in that bye week, that Norton actually tried to get to Lever in that round 19 game and sort of tried to play a little bit of sort of cat and mouse, and May actually let him go a couple of times, and Norton was able to get a couple of marks. So they've had a good look at that. Whether they go with the same sort of role there with Norton trying to get to Lever and see if they can maybe get Lever out of the contest or in the contest, but right under the top. But it's going to be a really interesting sort of a little battle there, the way it goes around. So
it becomes an interesting game of who's going to hold their nerve. So if you want him to go to Lever, and Lever says, all right, well, I'll move out of the danger zone and take you out, that's not going to upset Melbourne if Norton's not there in goal-kicking range, is it? Or getting a lot of the contested ball in the corridor. So it's kind of, you've still got to play your own structure without compromising it, despite getting the matchup you want.
They've had 2 weeks to think about it, Chief. Can you imagine how many times that we've gone, oh, we are going to play like this on this person, and then 2 days later, they're like, oh, maybe we'll try that as well. So it'll be interesting to see what both coaches have come up. 2 weeks is a long time to
think. And then 30 seconds into the game, it all goes out the window. Something different's been thrown in there.
Because the other player that you didn't mention then is Josh Sakic, who did an amazing job on Alir Alir. So whether he is thrown into that mix to take care of Jake Lever.
No doubt Melbourne would have scouted this. And Sakic played it smart. So we saw Alir Alir, he dominated against in that first final against Geelong and took so many intercept marks. But Sakic actually got to the back of Alir Alir, or got in the way and protected Norton. So didn't touch the ball a lot, Josh Sakic. Kicked a couple of goals, but what he did is he made the interceptor accountable.
Yep.
So is it Norton that goes to Lever, or is it the tried and true method of Sakic, who played on Alir 2 weeks ago and did a fantastic job?
It was also a little bit difficult, I guess, for Alir because the ball was coming down all the time. I mean, it was one-way traffic, wasn't it? I expect this game to be a lot more even, so you'll get opportunities to work out where you want to position yourself and where you match up instead of just hanging on because we're under siege, which is what Port Adelaide were against the Doggies.
Well, and that's the one thing that Melbourne do well, is that they're the best slow defence team in the competition. Yeah. So the Bulldogs were able to run the ball out nice and quickly against Port Adelaide, and then obviously as intercept defender, you become out of position.
Yeah.
But when the ball was going slow, 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 which Melbourne have done fantastically this year, they're going to be out. Lever's going to be out of position himself. May's going to be out of position himself in the best possible position. So it's a different kettle of fish.
I think the real thing that's going to come down to it is our forward pressure.
Yep.
If we can, obviously, as we get the ball inside 50 from stoppage and those kind of things, if our forwards can lock it in and slow the ball down, slow their transition and rebound down, that's when Jake and Steve can set up, get the matchups they want, get the depth they want, and we can sort of dictate defensively how we want to play. But if vice versa, if they sort of slingshot out of there, our backs are scrambled and they've got to sort of find a way to defend the quick ball rather than the slow ball.
I think that's why it becomes such a difficult game to predict, because they're both good at defence, they're both good at offence. I mean, we've got the two best teams in the competition. It's really about handling the occasion and who plays their own game the best. That's probably going to get the points at the end of the day.
Jake and Stephen have got that great synergy at the moment, haven't they?
Absolutely, but you also got to remember, and Jackie did attest to this, that the system defensively is overall, all 18 players on the ground are involved in it. And if we don't allow and slow that movement up, and the role that those forwards play in clogging the corridor and not allowing the switch and not allowing the overlap, it puts too much pressure on those guys that are behind the footy. And I think that's what we've done so well all year, is just work together, in team defence. And that's why we've got, outstanding players in Jake and Steve being able to dominate in those areas that we speak of.
I saw some great footage of, and it's the buy-in from that. And when Max Gawn's played forward, you think Ruckman going forward might be not sort of a great defender, Chief, and not strong on doing the little things, but the captain of the football club, the Ruckman, has been going forward, playing an important role, swapping with Luke Jackson, but he buys in. He buys into team defence.
Yep.
You can have six Stephen Mays and six Jake Levers behind the ball if you don't get it slowed up, and it's coming through, as we saw Bailey Smith being involved in those passages of play for Bulldogs in the game against Port Adelaide. You can, kiss your night goodbye.
I love how good Luke Jackson's been too.
Yes.
I mean, Max is such a dominating presence, but he has a spell, whether he goes forward or he goes off. They're not losing anything because he's such a good athlete, this kid, Luke Jackson.
Absolutely, like freak of nature.
Yeah.
Kind of
is his nickname Pineapple?
No, not that I know of.
Oh, well, I heard a little whisper.
Well, before we go on, you need to explain that.
Someone told me that his nickname is Pineapple because he's didn't know what a pineapple was when he came to Melbourne. So, yeah,
the story's partly true.
Oh, here we go. Well, there we go. I
explained to him what a pineapple was when we were on a training camp 1 year, but his nickname is, in fact, Dogger.
Dogger Jackson.
Okay.
I like pineapple.
It's better, isn't it?
I think that's what Richmond will be calling him anyway.
I'll be calling him
the
pineapple.
Next time they meet. It is going to be an awesome game tonight and a brilliant battle inside the coach's box. For a closer look, let's head inside the Zero Lab, and here is David King and Lee Montagna to take a closer look.
You get to this point in the season, Joey, because you've got strong philosophies as a football club and strong principles in the way you play. So The game today will be decided by whose philosophy stands up for longer, the coaching arm wrestle.
Absolutely, and you can't waver. You've got to stick to what's got you to this point of the season, and it's going to be a fascinating matchup because when you look at the two philosophies, they are both really strong defensively, but they both do it in different ways. And as we take a look at the vision, and this is a stoppage. So we've spoken about this all year, Kingy. The Western Bulldogs, they love to have a numerical advantage around the ball. They bring up generally a half forward or two, where the Melbourne like to keep their plus one behind the footy to support their defence.
So it's a battle of who wins. And we don't know who's going to be more effective and actually perform better on the day. So it's McRae at this stage at the clearance. But you don't know who it's going to be that spits forward. It could be one of a whole host of players. Melbourne behind the football, that's what they want to do. They want to stay defensively strong. So we talked about the fingerprints of a dog stoppage. No two are the same. Sometimes they go with one extra, sometimes they go with two. Melbourne are comfortable to hold two. So who wins this? We don't know. But what we do know is going to be hard to score, take it Melbourne's way, but you are probably going to give the Dogs possession.
And this is a tactic that I saw in this game that I think Melbourne might go to a little bit more often. So see there, Gawn was happy to punch the ball away from the numerical advantage of the Western Bulldogs. They're thinking, well, if we keep it in tight, that suits them. Let's get it forward.
So this is what I think the game comes down to. So the Dogs are going to have plus one, sometimes plus two, as a rolling advantage. So wherever the ball tracks, they'll have an out number. But behind the ball, a holding advantage will be Lever, May, Salem. Name the player you want. So you're going to find it, I think, quite regular for passages of play to become eventless. There's going to be no scoring because the way Melbourne want to play and because of the way the Dogs
want to play. Spot on. Two really strong defences, but they do it differently. The Dogs defend around the football with extra numbers. That's how they get their turnovers. They do it with, you know, that hunting mentality. It's why they concede, you know, the least or second least inside 50s in the competition because they swarm with numbers in the footy. But then this is the flip side of it. Melbourne like to hold their advantage. We know all year their defenders will hold, and that is why they've had one of the best defences we've ever seen since Champion Data's been recording these stats, Kingy. When the ball goes inside their defensive 50, they very rarely get scored against. Because now look at their numerical advantage. They get their numbers back defensively. This is how they get their intercept game going. They win the ball back. Melbourne clear it. This time it goes to a stoppage. And guess what? It starts all over again. The arm wrestle starts all over again. They get back into positions. The Dogs start with their numerical advantage. Melbourne start with it behind the footy. And it's going to be able to see best man wins.
Rolling advantage versus holding advantage. Who wins? We've got no idea. But Dogs fans, don't scream at the TV to kick the ball long because you know where Lever is, Sarah.
Yes, thank you very much, guys, for your insights there in the Zero Lab. The midfield battle is going to be intense, particularly given the depth that the Western Bulldogs have there. Nathan, Tom Limbratore, is he a player that the Ds have put a lot of time and effort into basically working out how to stop him because he's such a pivotal one? Maybe not the high profile of a Bontempelli or a McRae, but he could be a match winner.
Yeah, for sure. We've put time into him, I'm pretty sure, in both games. Generally, it's been James Harms, Jack Viney type. Sometimes it's been a proper tag, other times it's just, you know, accountability at stoppage, sort of sit on his back and try and squash the advantage they get from him, you know, from the inside out. And obviously his supply from the inside out to those guys, Bontempelli, McRae, Smith, Hunter, these kind of guys, that's why we put some time into him. It'll be interesting today whether that works or not. You know, we're 1-1 throughout the year, and whether we even go to that tactic. I tend to think that they'll probably just go head-to-head. There may be an element of accountability at stoppage, but I think they'll rely on their power at stoppage versus our power at stoppage, and I think that's why it'll be a genuine arm wrestle, and whoever wins that battle, I think, comes out on top.
If the Dogs are to win, it'll be very interesting to see how Tom celebrates. He is one of the characters of the game, if we remember that glorious haircut after 2016. That's doing a bit.
I don't think it's unfair to say he's a bit different. I mean, we know he's a bit different. He basically marches to the beat of his own drum.
Just think of the poor old Barley Geckos that aren't going to get a game out of him this year because he managed to sneak over there after the last flag and play midfield for them. But in all seriousness, the second game played 44 minutes at half forward. So I reckon they've seen the tag in the first game and thought, right, we're going to move Tom and play him out of position a little bit to try and break that tag. It's hard to tag off the half forward and maybe bring him up to stoppage. He was pivotal in terms of the first quarter against Port Adelaide. So get him in. Get
him
in the middle.
I agree.
Just go head to head and tell him, Tom, go and get the ball. So you're right, Jonesy. That midfield battle is so important.
Mightn't be a haircut, but there'll be more ink, I'm sure, if he wins the Premiership. You can
something to
that.
Celebrate. It probably has got a bit of work to do if he's going to match the iconic celebrations of Jack Riewoldt and Mr. Brightside himself. I was stunned to learn you teed this up during the week going into the game.
How arrogant is that? How arrogant is it saying, after we win, I want to get up and sing with the Killers?
Yes, it was the Sunday after or before the grand final that I was planted, the seed was planted in my head by a friend of mine who's another Killers fan. And I asked early on in the week, and you say arrogant, Chief, I say confident.
It's a fine line, isn't it?
It's a tightrope, Chief. It's a very, very thin tightrope, but I walked the right side of it.
Speaking of confident, you're going to be oh so confident to pull off this look. This is how the Chief celebrated with Ben Dixon. Although that couldn't be a premiership celebration if Dicko's there.
No. This was...
sorry, Dicko.
I hope he's watching.
Bye.
This was actually the end of my career, so it was the last footy trip with the boys, and I thought I'll do something special for him. And
dressed
what
up
little
as
hair
Eminem.
I had, I thought I'll get it.
Slim Shady.
Fair to say it didn't come up that well.
Yeah, Eminem Slim Shady there, Chief. I don't mind that.
A little bit of something for the boys.
A little bit of sunshine. Speaking of sunshine, let's head back to sunny Perth, where Kath and Pav are standing by. Guys, you want to have a closer look at Marcus Fontempelli, the Western Bulldogs skipper? We know he is a megastar with a massive say on how tonight plays out.
Yeah, this is a really interesting discussion listening to you all talk about Liberatore and his influence. Yeah. And I'm interested to get your thoughts, Pav, on do you send Harms to Libra again, like earlier in the season?
Well, I was thinking they might send Harms to Libra, but hearing Nathan Jones in there, I sort of swung my thoughts. I would be staggered or shocked if he didn't go to him at stoppages. Yes, there's systems, but he's a player that you could definitely clap. In terms of Marcus Bontempelli and what Jonesy was just talking about, in round 19, when they did the Demons by 20 points, he was an absolute star. Had 31 disposals, kicked the two goals, 13 of his possessions were contested, had 9 clearances, and the list goes on. 10 inside 50s for 8 score involvements. Oliver and Petrarca both had plenty of the footy as well, but they were nowhere near as damaging as this man on screen was, Marcus Bontempelli. So that's a question for the Demons. You talk about, well, what are the Demons going to do and vice versa in that midfield battle? What's it going to look like? There's just stars everywhere. Mm. And I talk about stars because there's so many. We're going to get to this in a minute. And it's been identified for a long period of time. So here they are, the 6 of the best 15 this year. McRae and Oliver and Bontempelli, Liberatore, Petrarca and Gorn. You think about the high-end talent, Kath. McRae was taken at pick 6. Oliver taken at pick 4. Bontempelli also picked 4. Gorn was a bit later. Petrarca, of course, taken very early in the draft at number 2 as well. So not only have they been identified for a long period of time, Kath, but these guys are putting it together when it matters most, and it's going to go a long way, that midfield battle, to say who wins later tonight.
And just really all in their prime as we were watching the prelim final, and you're seeing Joel Selwood and Dangerfield up against the likes of Oliver and Petrarca. And Petrarca, Oliver just looked like of the Selwood Dangerfields 5 years ago.
But this is why today is so important, because they're about the same age, they're about the same time of their careers, and it's just going to be enthralling to watch that midfield battle.
6 of the best 15 players in the comp at the first centre bounce. How good.
How good indeed. It is going to be spectacular. Cannot wait for this game. And Nathan, we're going to let you go now. Thank you so much for coming in. Congratulations on the beautiful family news you've had. And whatever happens tonight for the Demons, I think you really should know you've played a massive part in it. So
thank
thanks
you.
For coming
thanks
in
absolutely.
And
well done,
sharing the journey. Hopefully you get
thank
a little
you.
Bit of shut-eye after the game.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, one player tonight with plenty of premiership heritage is young Cozzy Pickett, whose uncle, of course, is Byron Pickett, a Norm Smith medalist. And the always smiling Cozzy is hoping that he can add another premiership medallion to his family's collection a little later tonight.
What was Friday night like?
Yeah, it's an unbelievable feeling, like just having the crowd there and just how crazy it all was, just getting the win. And yeah, I think there was a lot of excitement out of that, just looking at all the smiles around the in the changing rooms.
Have you got a bit of an idea of, you know, how excited the Melbourne fans get every time you go near the footy?
I just love playing footy, and just hopefully I can bring a lot of smiles to these fans' face and just other supporters watching. And yeah, I think footy was brought into our family. We obviously seen Uncle Byron play in a grand final and yeah, won Norm Smith. Yeah, it's pretty special just playing footy. I just love playing the sport, love kicking goals, tackling, all of it, everything about footy I just love.
Kasai picking, look at the moves, look at the twist, look at the turn, Cozzy!
If you had the choice, and you could take the mark of the year, you could kick the goal of the year, or you could lay the tackle of the year, which order would they come in for you?
I reckon a chase down tackle would be pretty good, but...
That's the modern day footy, cos that's not what we want to hear, man.
But I love when people take marks. I just love watching that, and yeah, it'd be pretty special if I can finally get up and take one.
Could he give you the licence, or has he told you to stay down?
I think my role is to stay down, but if I'm confident enough to get up there, I think, yeah, I can fly for it. That's what staff tells me, so yeah, I think this game coming up, I think it'll be pretty special. If we're all lucky enough to, yeah, get a grand final, it'll be pretty special and we'll remember it for the rest of my life.
Well said, Cozzy. Good luck Saturday, mate. It's exciting. The grand final's always an exciting moment, but to have players such as yourself on the biggest stage, on the biggest day, is exciting, and we all are looking forward to watching you in action. So good luck.
Thanks heaps, Gary. Cheers for having me.
You're watching Grand Final Day on Fox pre-game, brought to you by Ford Ranger.
Of course, we are counting down to the Grand Final right here on Fox Footy, but footy season never really ends. The trading period is just around the corner, and starting Monday, October the 4th, Trading Day will be live every night at 5 p.m. All the news and opinions and all the big deals that will shape the seasons ahead. Premiership sides are assembled during these trade periods as we head over to Tom Morris now and John Ralph. Both will be crucial parts of our Trading Day show. Guys, give us an entree.
Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, lots to get through today. Let's get straight into it, Ralphie. The Melbourne Footy Club, they're playing today. What are their prospective deals at the end of the season?
Thank you, Tom. Well, the Demons' chase for Adam Chera was fairly mystifying given that they were never likely to secure him. And I think all it did was basically spook Luke Jackson. He's a WA boy. He would have had to have been the centrepiece of that trade. And so Freo have come hard for him. He's certainly not going anywhere. He is contracted. But look, I just think it was just very risky business. Now, they're established players. Michael Hibbard, his manager Paul Connors, will sign a new one-year deal for his client in the next couple of weeks. Great story, of course, given the loss of his brother and him getting back into the team. And Jack Melksham open to an offer at a third club, but certainly hasn't got any suitors yet. Now, I can tell you today that Josh Dunkley is negotiating a new deal for post-2022. It is extraordinary for a player who...
What a turnaround.
10 months ago, yeah, requested a trade. The Dogs held firm, of course. They got an Adam Treloar. They're best mates now. Now, Amit Baines, the club's chief executive, tells me that the list boss in Sam Power and certainly Liam Pickering are working through that deal. Yeah, astonishing, really, and just fantastic to see what this club's been able to do. Now, a couple of the other Bulldogs boys, were
there? Yeah, Mitch Wallace, two-year deal on the table for him. He's got a big decision to make. He's an unrestricted free agent. Stephen Martin, he won't hit his trigger, but he is very keen to play on next year. The Dogs are looking for a ruckman. Now, Adam Chera, has he made up his mind, Ralphie?
He has. We've both reported today that he will play for the Carlton Football Club. He'll officially request that trade in a couple of days there. Look, he's 21. He kicks it beautifully. Third in the best and fairest for Freo last year. Get a deal done early, potentially with pick six, and then both Carlton and Freo potentially can get other deals done as well. Jordan Dawson, a Sydney player who has chosen Adelaide. Yep. How does that deal get done?
Yeah, the Sydney offer was $600,000 a year by five. The Adelaide offer is $650,000 by five, but this is not about money. This is about family. Now, the Adelaide Crows don't want to give up pick four. They also don't want to give up a future first rounder, so these negotiations could go deep. But Ralphie, tell me about Hawthorn under Sam Mitchell, a new era.
That's right. So I think in an ideal world, they would have secured an extra first round pick. Their picks are 5, 21 and 24. And, of course, you know, you need a multiple amount of picks there to try and get that premiership dynasty going. Tom Mitchell, though, has made very clear he does not want to leave that football club through his management. He will stay, I think, in an ideal world, potentially halfway through the year, as you reported. Yeah. If there was a win-win deal, he could have got to a premiership team. That might have happened. It won't now. And with 9 days out from the trade period, I think none of those 28-year-old players, the likes of Gunston, Wingard and O'Meara, will leave. So it's not perfect for their list build, but great for Sam Mitchell in that short-term future there. What about the Saints, another club very keen to bounce back into the finals?
Yeah, absolutely they are. Well, Seb Ross is waiting. Well, the club is waiting on Seb Ross. He's got a two-year deal with a trigger for a third on the table. There's not a lot of interest from elsewhere. He is a free agent. Now, Tom Cleary, the Saints asked the question of Cleary's manager. Yep. He's on a back-ended deal at Port Adelaide, so I can't see him leaving. He's just too expensive for the Saints. They are looking for a defender. But speaking of Port Adelaide, Jeremy Finlayson on their radar. Peter Laddams, is he going to be there next year?
Yeah, I don't think that he will. Certainly in his exit meeting, it was raised that he potentially should move on and have a look if he wanted to be a first ruckman. somewhere. Port Adelaide are saying we certainly didn't force him out. Yep. He's himself third year of a back-ended deal, so he doesn't want to go for peanuts. It means that St Kilda and Brisbane, who are looking for really cheap backup ruckman, they're not likely to be suitors. But certainly the Western Bulldogs, and look, I just think Geelong, you know, they haven't been able to find that premiership ruckman for a very long time. They would have to be someone that's in contention as well. Finlayson, he asked for the medical report. He wants to come home. I think if it was a late pick, I think it was a very modest deal, but I think he's probably more likely to stay at GWS right now. The Eagles, they've got to do something, Tom.
They do. Just on Port, Riley Bonner and Robbie Gray have agreed to one-year deals, so they'll be there next year. Robbie Gray, of course, is a star of that club. Now, West Coast, Michael Vozzo, the head of football, he stepped away for the trade period.
Craig Vozzo,
stepped away for the trade and the draft period, which is unusual for a head of football. I spoke to Trevor Nisbet today, their CEO. He said he's up for a well-earned break. So Ron O'Brien, the list manager, will look after their trade period and their draft. Shannon Hearn and Josh Kennedy will re-sign on reduced deals. And Jared Brander's future is unclear. It must be said. I think Carlton and Hawthorn have elements of interest in him, and Sam Patrici-Seddon, he'll probably get there for a late second or third round pick. The Dockers, they'd love a midfielder to replace Adam Scherer. Not sure who's out there. Lachie Neal's not going to go there anymore. But Collingwood, Ralphie, they don't have a lot of money, not many picks. How can they get creative?
Well, they're going to get smart. They're already in points deficit, obviously, with Nick Dacos right now. So they're going to have to really haggle hard for a couple of players who want to come in. So Nathan Kruger will move across from Geelong on a three-year deal. 196 centimetre swing man. We haven't heard a lot about him, but he's only played two games for Geelong. Geelong used up pick 42 for him a couple of years back. They'll ask the world. Collingwood says you don't play him. Very similar with Pat Lipinski. Now, Geelong have... Pat Lipinski, the Western Bulldogs have offered him a three-year deal, so that we're very keen to play you. Collingwood will say, you played us twice as the sub in the second half of the year, so we'll give you a late throwaway pick. So, look, you know, Collingwood's likely to haggle pretty hard on that just because, given they haven't really got a lot of picks to try and throw around. But if they can get all three of those players in, they're going somewhere. The Suns, the Lions, the Brisbane clubs, what are they doing?
Yeah, just very quickly, Brisbane's after a cheap ruckman. They've re-signed 35 of their players. Archie Smith, of course, has retired. Gold Coast...
Mason Cox, I reckon he makes a bit of sense.
Yeah, Mason Cox does make some sense
4 years ago.
Will Mason Cox be at Collingwood next year?
He's desperate to stay there. I think he has very few suitors, and so, look, it'll be a significant pay cut. He is a good enough player to be in the league, but I think it's probably his cheapest chips deal.
And just to finish, Sarah, Gold Coast and Essendon have some preliminary interest in Luke Dunstan. That'll probably happen more towards the rookie draft or even the pre-season draft. There's plenty going on. Trading Day, you can watch it from October 4 on Fox Footy with Ralphie, Lee Montagna and David King. It's going to be a very interesting little period indeed.
It certainly will. It is all happening already. Thank you very much to Tommy and also Ralphie. Jack, do the players kind of keep tabs on the moving and manoeuvring of everyone over this period?
A little bit. I suppose if with your own club, we've obviously been linked to Robbie Tarrant, so hopefully he comes across as an unrestricted free agent, but a couple of young key forwards as well moving from our football club, it looks like. So you do keep a little bit. You might, when you get a little longer in the tooth, Chief, you start asking to get some good players into your, older players into your club maybe, but I think for us, we'll go to the draft pretty strong at Richmond.
Why do you think he looked at me when he said get a bit longer in the tooth?
I found out how old you were tonight.
You've already had a crack at me today.
Found out how old you were tonight.
Yeah, as soon as age gets spoken about, it comes my way.
Tips for tonight, and who do you think's going to win the Norm Smith Medal, please?
I've got a massive, massive rating on Aaron Norton, but I think Stephen May can do the job. So I'm tipping Melbourne by 11 points, and I'm going to pick Stephen May for the Norm Smith Medal.
I went Melbourne by 10, and no spoil, Clayton Oliver to get the job done.
Melbourne by 16 and Big Maxi to cap off a fairy tale.
Nice.
I think it'll be close.
Let's hope so. We just want a good game.
Yeah.
Oh, well, grand final day right here on Fox Footy continues. We've got our new panel coming in. Kelly Underwood to lead the team. Jared Healy, Jordan Lewis and Tony Armstrong. So stick around grand final day on Fox Footy. There's plenty of hearts beating true around Melbourne today for the red and blue, including these two famous demons.
Grand final day. How do you think you'll be when you wake up that day?
On medication, I think. I go, my mother got a pacemaker. She got into football. She said it's amazing to watch close games with a pacemaker.
Yeah.
I might get one installed.
More serious question. Yeah. Where's your scarf?
I don't want to moz it.
You don't want to moz it?
I've got one at home and I've made a commitment. No scarves, no cheese boards until we...
Did you see any premierships?
No, I think I was two. So, yeah, I mean, you would have been 30 when the last
And I was there. There's no need to be a smart ass right through this thing.
Hey, we're together.
And I was there in 64. How do you feel now that we, Melbourne, have suddenly become everyone's second club?
Oh, I love it.
It was never going to happen, was it?
I just absolutely... Because you know, it's fortunately there's a generation that have grown up not knowing how despised we were.
Yeah.
And that feeling sorry for us has been converted into sort of a, you know, the second team phenomenon, which I love.
It won't be fun if we lose, but I think this is the best chance that we've had in half a century.
I don't know what you do on grand final day when you've got a genuine chance. Like, I don't know what you feel.
No. What are you going to do for 10 hours?
Drink, I think, but I don't know. Have an illegal gathering.
But we can't do that because it's too important if things go the way we want.
Yeah. Yeah.
To be looking through the bottom of a beer glass.
Oh, yeah, no. I go, I won't, I watch, I, if we win, I'll watch the replay 4 times.
By yourself?
Happy to.
Yeah.
Yeah, wouldn't matter. It's seriously, I don't need to drink at that moment. I just want to watch it again and again and again.
Just before we part company.
Don't.
Can you put your hand on
Mike?
Can I put it around
your neck? Mike, you'll require a concussion test if you do.
You're watching Grand Final Day on Fox pre-game, brought to you by Ford Ranger.
Hey.
Remember the name! Unbelievable!
You guys are under some serious heat, I reckon.
Incredible scenes.
Good afternoon and welcome back to Fox Footy's coverage and countdown to the 2021 AFL Grand Final. It's all thanks to Ford Ranger, and we've got three new experts joining us this afternoon. Got a couple of former Demons and some would say an angel sometimes on the end there. Tony Armstrong, Jordan Lewis and Jared Healy. Happy Grand Final day.
Isn't it great that we're finally here, Kel?
Yes.
It's been a long way in the making, but we're finally here, gents.
Well, the Melbourne supporters and the Western Bulldogs supporters have had 2 weeks, so it hasn't felt rushed as it would be in the past, but I feel for the players. It'll have been a long wait. Mm.
Some would say it feels like an eternity, really.
Well, I mean, I can imagine that they would have played the game over and over in their head that first week, but I think this last week, really sharpening up, getting ready for the game tonight.
And we just saw the intro there. It means as of tomorrow, officially cricket season begins because the AFL season will be over. I've just got to quickly congratulate you on your cricket coverage. You've been leading the coverage when it comes to particularly the latest injury news. Have a look at this.
Is set to undergo neck surgery, but medical staff remain confident that the veteran will be fit for the Ashes. Payne has a bulging disc that has been causing him pain. I'm going to throw to you very quickly, Michael.
Bulging what?
Disc. I said disc.
That's what I thought you said.
Thank you, Tony.
I'm just going to drink water.
Mate, over to you.
I had to embarrass you right off the top.
Thanks so much, Kel. We are colleagues over at the ABC at times on Offsiders, and this is what I walk into.
Yes.
But I'm pretty sure I'm not the only person on this panel that's had a gaffe this year.
And here's one bloke that's getting no attention whatsoever. Daily Bale. Dale Bailey. I'll get it right. Bailey Dale.
That's actually only a minor one for me.
Do you know when the producer said to me, we've got Jared's slip up, I went, oh, I don't think we can put that on TV again.
The Gold Coast?
Yeah. What are they called again?
Oh, well, some said it was pretty accurate at the time. They have improved since.
All right, we're off to a flyer. Less than 2 hours to go until the official bounce. We're all excited, as you can tell. Let's get serious. We're going to touch base with Simon Goodwin very, very soon, so looking forward to crossing to him in Perth. But, Jared, first of all, I mean, I said we've got a couple of Demons here. You played 130 games for Melbourne. I've heard a lot about this Norm Smith curse. Mm. If we go back to the 1960s, I mean, Melbourne was the strongest footy team in the competition. Legendary coach Norm Smith led them to 6 flags in 15 years in charge. They inexplicably sacked him the very next year, and some believe as he walked out the door that Norm Smith cursed this club. There's been no premiership since 1964. Surely, Jared Healy, curses are made to be broken.
I agree with that. I'd never heard of the Norm Smith curse when I turned up at Melbourne, but I do know from personal experience it's very powerful. When Ron Barashi turned up, I was driving across the Nullarbor and I thought to myself, well, I'll be a premiership player next year. Ron Barashi came to Melbourne in 81 with a 5-year plan. I didn't know it was so powerful, the curse, it would last 30 years. So it's the Barassi 30-year plan that is going to be broken today, hopefully for Demon supporters.
And, Geordie, you played 300-plus games of AFL. Your last 3 years were in the red and blue. How many of these players, how many of the 22 that are about to run out there in Perth have contacted you this week? Because you haven't tasted success once on this day. You've done it four times.
Yeah, a few have, and that's been quite nice, I suppose. It's always a little bit nerve-wracking going into something that you'd never been a part of. I mean, they've got Jake Lever there. He's been on grand final day, albeit it was probably one that he'd like to forget. But Simon Goodwin's another one that they can touch base with. Adam Uze was involved at Hawthorn at the time when we were going through that successful period. So there's a lot of... And Mark Williams. So there's a lot of touch points that they can actually access through. But, yeah, it was quite humbling. I had conversations with about four or five players just to calm their nerves, I suppose, and just, you know, set them straight and make them understand that the hysteria around a game of AFL and a grand final especially is huge. So whatever you can do as a player to play that down is certainly works in the favour.
And what were some of those things that you said to them in terms of, I guess, tactics?
I think, you know, I would always draw back on past experiences. So some of those players that phoned me up, I would ask them, how did they feel coming into the prelim final? And they said, I was really nervous. How did you perform? I performed really well. Well, there's a recent experience that you can draw back on. It's exactly the same. Repeat that, what you did 2 weeks ago, and you'll be fine. I think players, we tend to build this up to be this massive occasion, which it is, but once you're out there, once the ball is bounced, everything starts to feel familiar.
I think handling the pressure is a lot easier when you're asked to play your role. And yep. This has come through psychologists, through experienced personnel. Take the pressure down. Take the pressure off people. I mean, Clayton Oliver's going out there to play his role. Most people expect him to be thinking about being in the best two or three players on the ground because he's probably going to have to be for Melbourne to win. Same for Max Gawn and Petrarca and the same for Bont. But in their own mind, they're just saying, play your role. Let's apply pressure. Let's tackle. Don't worry about what happens with the footy. That eventually happens. But that must take the pressure down.
And I think on top of that, it's making sure that you're giving yourself every chance to go out there and perform by making sure that your preparation is squeaky clean. You're doing everything you've done all year round so that when you get out there, you've left no stone unturned.
Let's highlight how far this D's team has come because it was just over 12 months ago, about 13 months ago, when they were thrashed by Port Adelaide by 51 points. And the then President Glenn Bartlett unleashed a verbal attack on the back page of the Herald Sun when he spoke to John Ralph, describing them as disgraceful, insipid. And the quote there, when you pull on a Melbourne jumper, we don't give them out as Wheaties packets. And there was a bit of tension clearly behind the scenes. And since then, a smooth transition earlier this year, Glenn Bartlett stood down in that position as the president. But since then, Geordie, I mean, they've gone on with just seven losses. So this was round nine last year, three losses towards the end of the season and just the four losses this year.
Yeah, I didn't have a problem with it at the time. Yeah. I know there was a lot of hysteria around it. How should a president come out and he's not the one that's out there playing and all those types of things. I didn't have a problem with it because I think for years it was just accepted that at some point Melbourne would fail and no one would come out and really challenge the side. And I quite like what he did. It put everyone on notice, the coaching staff, the players, whoever was involved in that football club, that it's something that they won't stand for anymore. And you're right, they've had an upward trajectory ever since and everything starts to click, but it was a big moment.
I think as well, we talk about top-down leadership, two female presidents of both the clubs, Kate Roffey and Kylie Watson-Wheeler at the Dogs as well. Fantastic stuff. Recently, we've seen Peggy O'Neill leading the Tigers. It's just great to see and, I guess, showing that football is progressing off the field as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So it means the last three, whoever wins tonight, the last three presidents will be led by women. The match is littered with wonderful stories, brilliant storylines right across. One is Steph Martin. He's got the job of stopping Max Gawn, and you've got to go back about a while. He played 57 games in 5 years at the D's. He sat down with Kath Lochnan during the week and spoke about that matchup, that huge blockbuster matchup that looms against Max Gawn.
Playing against your first club in Melbourne. Yeah. I mean, does that blow your mind how it's panned out?
It does. Like, it feels like an eternity ago that I was there, the way, you know, I was in Brisbane for the 8 years, and so it was a long time ago.
Boy plays on, runs to 30, spectacular!
Are there people still there you're close to?
Yeah, I mean, Nath Jones I played with and Nev Jetta and obviously Max Gawn, so He's a good mate, and now he's going to be a good rival.
You got a big smile on your face when you mention Max Gawn.
It's hard not to. I bet you he will do that as we line up at the centre bounce. He's just that type of guy.
Smile.
Oh, he'll smile. He'll be joking the whole game probably.
Will you smile back?
That's something I've got to work out.
What are the options here?
Probably some gamesmanship in that. The options are play the game or give him nothing. And he's the funny one, so maybe I'll leave that to him and I'll just play the game.
I'm getting into too much ruckcraft. You guys wouldn't know much about that.
You know, he was obviously a really tantalising prospect, but he wasn't the complete package yet.
Gawn in the middle! And he went with it!
I remember playing him the first time that after I'd been traded, and I was just thinking, where has he developed this running base from? Like, it just wasn't a strength that I'd seen before, and all of a sudden he was this great runner as well as his other strengths.
Max, the skipper, on the run.
A quirky personality like his.
Sometimes I struggle to get jeans that fit me, so I go for that little hipster look with the ankles out.
The love that he's been able to rise, to the top of the organisation and stay true to who he is, I reckon that's awesome that they've embraced him for that too.
So some great insights there, Steph Martin, Jordan Lewis. Would you play the game or would you go the smirk at that opening bounce? We'll all be watching.
I'd smile back. Yeah, I'd play the game with you. I mean, they are great mates. I actually met Steph through Max when we were up in Queensland on a pre-season camp, and we ventured up to Brisbane and had dinner with Steph. Steph is a lovely person. I mean, as you could see through that interview there, but he's got a hell of a task on him, as well as the players in the Melbourne camp would have had a hell of a task trying to bring Max Gawn back down to earth after the prelim final game, because he comes across a little bit quirky, but there's an underlying arrogance about him, so there would have been a job there in itself.
I think the one thing we've got to accept is that Steph Martin in his own right is a hell of a player. Now, he's had a poor preparation, but particularly early, he's a great athlete. The best way to stick it up, Max, is to stick it up him by kicking goals at the other end of the ground and make Max chase and take the game away from Max, make Max actually start to second-guess himself a little bit. So this is not just a one-sided affair. And Luke Beveridge will have something. I'm not sure what it's going to be, but he will have something that challenges Melbourne and tries to destabilise Melbourne. Whether or not it's the ruckman, I'm not sure, but Steph Martin's a good player, shouldn't be underestimated.
What about, this Max Gawn story? It's quite remarkable when you have a look at it. He's started from a long way back, a couple of knee reconstructions, and he has emerged as a true champion of the game.
He's got five All-Australians now. I can remember going to Nathan Brown's first Best and Fairest victory, and Max was famous then for being a great MC. Now he's famous because he's an unbelievably good player and potentially a drought-breaking premiership captain. It's been a great tribute to him.
And I think there's something really special about big men who play well and chuck the side on their shoulders and get it done. Like, we're seeing some footage here from that prelim, kicking goals. Like, you shouldn't be doing that as a ruckman, taking on one, snapping it over your shoulder. It's unbelievable to see, and it really lifts you. And, of course, he gets first look. He gets to set the scene for them tonight. He'll get that first jump. It's going to be great to see how him and Steph do battle.
So, Geordie, take me into the insight, the mindset here of Max Gawn. When you've played the game of your life, you kicked five goals in a prelim, you played the game of your life in the biggest game to date. How do you back up?
I think he was realistic even after the game when he was interviewed. He knew that some of those shots at goal, he can't even do at training. So he was realistic. I mean, the most surprising thing is players like Max Gawn can polarise people. So you think because they've got that larrikin type of personality, that is the way they are at training. He's a killer. And he works so hard, and Steph Martin brought up his endurance base. He works his absolute backside off at training, really pushes himself. And not only is he a good leader because of the personality, but he's a good leader because he works hard. And that is filtered straight through the playing group.
I think we still haven't recognised the clarity between Simon Goodwin and probably Mark Williams to make him the individual captain. I mean, Jack Viney and him were co-captains a couple of years ago, and yet they made the call that it's going to be Max and Max alone. They saw something in Max, and from that minute on, it was a tough pill for Jack to swallow, and he swallowed it, and he's got back to his very best form. But without doubt, Max Gawn, it's been the making of him, and it may well be the making of this team.
Yeah, it was with Jonesy, and I think because the reason why Jack probably steps aside because of his injuries, he wasn't able to get continuity within in terms of playing. So it was a chance for him to go regroup, and they just had someone in Max Gawn there waiting to go.
Well, waiting to go is the D's coach because he's been good enough to join us in the lead up to the 2021 AFL Grand Final. He's just stepped out of the team meeting. Simon Goodwin, the day has finally arrived. When you woke up this morning, what was your very first thought?
Oh, my thought was one of excitement, one of anticipation, and one of...
Well, we might be having some technical issues with that line there, Simon.
Preparations.
Yeah, we might try and clear that line up and get back to Simon very, very shortly. We obviously appreciate his insight with that. And standing by is John Ralph, who happens to be in the newsroom. Ralphie, we'll cross to you first. We're about to talk to Simon Goodwin. And it's a fascinating story, this one as well, because there were times where he looked a little bit shaky in that hot seat.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, his coaching performance has been absolutely extraordinary. And it's why he will be handed a coaching extension past 2022 in the off-season. Now, I've spoken to Chief Executive Gary Pert. He said the club has barely had time to scratch itself, given how turbulent the last few weeks have been. But he says as soon as we get into the cold, hard light of day through summer, we'll be able to give him that extension. Now, you think 2 years tacked onto that deal, 2024... If he wins the premiership, he might just be a Demons coach for life. Now, the Demons had hoped to make $4 million this year. They've had all of that wiped by COVID, and then they've just made $1 million through merchandise in the last couple of weeks. If they can win the premiership, though, Pert says they'll tack an extra couple of $1 million onto that, and they'll be really going places. Record membership, you think, next year. Now, at the Dogs, Chief Executive Mate Baines tells me the last 5 weeks in the Odyssey across those five states, he said, has been the making of this football club. They'd lost three in a row. They'd lost their identity. He says Luke Beveridge's ability to bring this club together and actually, you know, identify what they stand for at its been absolutely extreme. Now, he says, of the millions of reasons why we'd love to win the flag, one of them is so we can release the footage publicly of Luke Beveridge in his pre-match addresses. He says, it's just been off the charts inspiring. It's been absolutely extraordinary. So, you know, Luke Beveridge absolutely at the top of his game there. Now, just on the Demons and their build-up, one game in 28 days. Now, a lot of people have suggested it's not enough football. Well, Gary Pert says they are timed and tuned to the minute. Gary, their football boss and their list boss in Darren Burgess has done an extraordinary job in their fitness. He says, physically and mentally, we have had the best preparation we could dream about. Adam Tomlinson only out of their best side. He says, we know it guarantees nothing, but there are no excuses here. So, guys, are you at all concerned by, effectively, one game in 28 days of football?
No, I'm not. I think it... When you finish the season and you have a couple of weeks off, you build that thirst for football again. So I think it's exactly what especially Melbourne could feel. You haven't had that stuff that you love, that stuff to go out there and play and perform. You've had that effectively taken away for a few weeks. I think the passion and the energy will be there.
I think as well, over the last 18 months, we've seen preparations be far from perfect. So the players, it's just another new thing for them to do. Both teams are in the same camp. They're going to get out there and they're going to get it done.
So who would you rather be? One game in 28 days. And the one game really was a bit of a training run against the Cats. Yeah. And then, of course, the Dogs had that... Well, they've travelled five states, 10,000 kilometres.
I would rather have the Dogs' preparation. I think the numbers tell you that the end-of-season bye pre-finals has worked against the top sides. But this is a new bye. Both sides have now had a two-week break, so who knows, Kel? It's a new area.
OK, take two. Let's go to Simon Goodwin because he's standing by. Simon, apologies about those technical issues. Thanks for sticking around. And you've had time to think about it now. What was your first thought this morning when you woke up?
Yeah, I woke up this morning. It was one of excitement, one of anticipation. It's a day that we've waited for a long time as a footy club. And obviously, as a coach, you wake up thinking about your preparation and making sure that it's all ready to go. So, yeah, I'm excited. I can't wait. We're looking forward to it.
Goody, congratulations. A brilliant effort by you. We've just been talking about who's got the best preparation. To me, the best preparation that I've read about is yours, going up to Yanchep and having a pot and a Palmer. Which style of beer is best preparation for a premiership?
I went for the local Carlton draft, I enjoyed that. Now, it was just a bit of time to reflect, Jared, and get away from the game just for a few hours, laid on the beach for an hour, and I couldn't do too much. I'm pretty white skin, and I burn up pretty easily. So went up to the pub and had a Palmer and a pot, and, drove back. So it was just nice to get away and clear the head.
Goody, you just stepped out of the final team meeting. What was the last message that you wanted the players to sort of dwell on, I suppose, over the last sort of half an hour and go into the game with?
Yeah, look, we've been really consistent of just being us, you know. We've wanted to build a brand that's built around defence in our contest, and we know that's going to be important for us today. The Dogs, you know, they thrive off scoring, they thrive off winning with chains of out of the contest areas. So our ability to defend those things and just be us would be just enough.
Hey, Goody, congratulations, mate. What a year you've had. How much of your own experience, 97, 98, have you injected into the lead-up to tonight?
Yeah, look, a fair bit. You know, I've just had some quiet words with a number of guys, and it's just been around the week. You know, you've got to enjoy it. You've got to actually welcome the opportunity that presents in front of you and not be fearful of it. You know, the day when you arrive, and it has been when we've arrived, it's different. You know, there's stages, there's speakers everywhere, there's a bit more music and a bit more buzz around the ground. But once that ball's bounced, it's just going to be us and our ability to execute our roles.
Goody, it seems that every club at match committee go through the what ifs. What if this happened? What if this guy got injured? When you're sitting down with Jocko Williams and your match committee, what was the biggest what if that troubled you?
Oh, look, clearly their midfield's, you know, one of great strength. You know, they bring some high half forwards up to stoppage and clearance, and they run really deep through the middle of the ground. They've got some quality players, liver on the inside. You know, Bond can go inside and outside. So they do that incredibly well. So that's one area that we're going to have to really focus on. You know, both teams rely on forward half footy and obviously our ability to maximise our strengths behind the ball. You know, we've been a team that have won contests behind the ball. You know, they took it away from us really well in round 19. We've learned from that and, you know, we've got some plans in place.
OK, Soma, before we let you go, we're 90 minutes away from the opening bounce. Can you confirm your sub, your Medi sub for us? Is it James Jordan?
Yeah, look, it will be JJ. You know, he's been our sub for the last 4 weeks. He's had a fantastic season. He's a young player that can play multiple roles. So, he'll be our medical sub today.
OK, Simon, on behalf of every D's fan that's probably glued to their TV set that can't get to the game in Perth tonight, very best of luck for the game tonight.
Thank you. And to all the fans back home, you know, we're obviously very excited for them. It's been 57 years. It's been a long time. You know, we'll be doing our absolute best and hopefully make them proud.
Simon Goodwin, the coach of the D's. Of course, he was the coach of the year. Will he be the coach of the 2021 Premiers? We will know later this evening. Stick around. We've got still plenty to preview, including, is this man Mr. September and will his hairstyle catch on? We're going to find out a little bit more about Bailey Smith.
Apart from your football ability, the hair gets a lot of attraction. Yeah. Tell me the story behind it.
It's just, I don't know, I've always aspired to want to grow a mullet and sort of started in school when our hair had to be off our ears and off the collar and stuff. Since I finished, it hasn't stopped growing. I just trim it every now and then, but yeah. That's about it.
So I broke the school rules and just kept doing it your way?
Well, it just sort of inspired me to be like, what does it feel like to have longer hair? Because they would never let us feel that unless it was summer. And yeah, so I had a crack at that and yeah.
Yeah, put it in a pony?
Never. No, I was contemplating, but I don't know. I think it's either this or buzz cut, maybe.
You're watching Grand Final Day on Fox pre-game, brought to you by Ford Ranger. Where do we begin? I've never been closer than I am right now. It drives us, inspires us, brings us together. And when that whistle goes, the world disappears.
Unbelievable! Oh, yes! I love it! Wow, the big guy! Thank you very much.
We can never predict it, but we can always rely on it. For these thrills, that joy, this romance,
this fine batsman rises again.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Those feels.
Take a bow.
For our team, for our passion, for the love of sport.
Can you believe we got here? It is the last day of the 2021 AFL season, but it doesn't mean sport finishes. Tony Armstrong, Jordan Lewis, Jared Healy, what are you looking forward to? Which sport over summer?
Man. Ashes, always Ashes.
Okay, fingers crossed for those Ashes.
Yeah, I'm cricket as well. Yeah, maybe a little bit of surfing on the side. I thought you might have went surfing. But
prefer to do it than watch it. Got to be honest. Yeah. Oh, it's great on the Fox. Yeah. But,
hey, we don't
want to follow that up.
Yeah, we don't want another slip up, okay? We don't want another. Go, Tony.
NFL. I love American football.
All right, no worries. I'm looking for the AFLW. Yeah. Come on, guys. Footy's just quiet for a couple of months, and then it fires up again in January. And of course, it's all on Fox Footy. Another award will get announced after the grand final, and that is the Gary Ayres Award for Best Finals Player. Dustin Martin has won this 3 out of the last 4 years. Is Bailey Smith the new Dustin Martin? Is he the new Mr. September? I think he trails Jack McRae in the coaches' votes. But is he due for another big one tonight, do you think, Tone?
I think we might be going early on calling him Mr. September. It's a pretty small sample size, but what we have seen, we've seen him really step up in huge games. I mean, that semi-final, his poise under pressure, we've just seen him kick that goal to seal the game against the Lions, that one-point win. The way he plays, he's so dynamic, and he feels really talismanic, kind of like Liam Picken was in the 2016 run. There's a bit of that about him as well, hitting the scoreboard, doing the tough things. I love watching him.
Look, it's very much, I think, a big difference between the two sides. They've got Bailey Smith and they've got Adam Treloar, high half forwards, effectively midfield types who go up to the stoppage. On the other hand, you've got the Demons, who have got the likes of Alex Neil-Bullen, James Harms, who are pressure players. They're not there to get 30 possessions and kick 3 goals. Harms may kick a goal, Alex Neil-Bullen may kick a goal, but they're there to nail their halfbacks.
So it's a great point. You think the difference in the contest could be, we all talk about what's happening in the middle, but out wide on those wings and the run and the attack that those two players bring.
Well, I think that's a great difference between the two sides. They've both got great defences, they've both got great midfields, but it's a difference of style. Melbourne are very much pressure half forwards, whereas the Dogs are using them as high midfielders. And if it transpires that the Dogs win, then that is going to be one of the reasons.
Love that insight. Jared Healy, how do the Dogs control the influence of the two midfield bulls in the middle for Melbourne? Of course, I'm talking about Christian Petrarca and Clayton Oliver. We got our very own Nick Dal Santo. Do some homework during the week and he's broken it down. Dal.
Well, thanks, Cal, and thanks to Zero. Let's have a really close look at this D's midfield and what has made them so good this year with their ability to take the hit and then make the play. They've got the biggest bull in the paddock, Christian Petrarca, who loves the physicality. He also loves to burst away from contest and give the ball off on his terms. And when you've got Big Mac Scorn kicking him from 55, you know it's going to be their day. Petrarca can do it from a stoppage, but he can also do it in contested situations on centre wing. So there's the initial contact. He doesn't panic. He knows he has the raw strength to burst away from this contest and give it off to a teammate forward of the football so they can go forward again. But he's not alone. He's got Clayton Oliver as his wingman, who has similar ability and similar strengths in the contest. He comes against the grain with contact on him once again. This is going to be a huge challenge of the Western Bulldogs. Can they slow this man down? Doesn't panic. Slung in a tackle. Has those options going forward of the football. From the Western Bulldogs, you've got to stick that initial tackle, but then also cover off that receiver. You can't allow the D's to come out of the front of any contested situation.
OK, Nick Dal Santo's insights there. Jared, give us your... I mean, it's a million-dollar midfield, both these teams. Where do you start? Let's start with Josh Dunkley, because he's done the job on quite a few of the opposition big midfields in the final series already.
Yeah, in many ways, he epitomises the Western Bulldogs. Prior to their first final, he was struggling. He was just getting back into the side and he was struggling. At halftime, Darcy Parrish was dominating that game. And Luke Beveridge found a way, A, to win the game, but to find a way for Josh Dunkley to find his very best form by putting him onto Darcy Parrish. And Dunkley found some really good form. He went on to Lachie Neale. He curtailed him. Ollie Wines had plenty of possessions, Ollie. But Dunkley also had 4, 3 and 4 clearances himself. Now, the question is, does he go to Clayton Oliver? Well, I would probably start him on a Clayton Oliver or a Petrarca, but Petrarca can go to the forward line. Of more interest to me is where does Viney go? Does Viney go to the Bont, or does Viney go to McRae, or does Viney go to Libba, as you anticipated he might earlier this afternoon? But if he does go to the Bont goes forward, so then he may have to then go to McRae. So there's this old merry-go-round that can go on through the middle of the ground.
I think both sides will back their system in initially, and we've seen him tag within games. I think Melbourne will take the same approach. Let's see how we go head-to-head. Then if we need to go to something like that, well, you've got Viney, who can do a shutdown role, Harms, who can do a shutdown role, and for the Western Bulldogs, you've got Dunkley. So they've got that up their sleeve.
I remember driving in to Marvel Stadium, round 11 it was. It was a Friday night, listening to you on the radio, and you were the first person to put it out there. Forget tagging Bont, I would tag Libba. And you said you'd put Harms on Libba, and that's what happened, and it sort of flowed on from there.
Yeah, well, it's just... Bontempelli's hard to tag in a sense that he's...
Can he go forward?
He can go forward and he spreads from the stoppage. You don't know whether if he's spreading that he comes back and continues on being a midfielder. He might stay half forward. So Liberatore was the easy one because you know where he will be most of the time.
Can you tell us what happened? I think it was 2013 with Sam Mitchell, your teammate in that game.
Yeah, so I think from Liberatore's mindset going into the game, he might anticipate that he's going to get a tag. That might not come. So he might in the first quarter and a half, had to play his own game. Then if there's a tag that comes and someone sits on him, then he has to adapt. So Sam Mitchell had Ryan Crowley, played pretty much a defensive type of role in the midfield into their hit zone and was really influential with, you know, 12 touches. So Liberatore might have to change the way he plays in game as well.
OK, of the 22 All-Australians that were picked this year, 8 are playing in this game tonight. Mm. Probably the lowest profile would have to be their halfback, Bailey Dale.
Or his cousin, Dale Bailey. But if I'm going into
this... How important is he?
Oh, I think he's fantastic. I mean, right from the word go when I stuffed it up on the couch. Round 4, this guy was clearly one of the most influential players of the day. And on the weekend... You know, last 2 weekends ago, he was superb. His distribution by foot is unbelievable. And, of course, you've got Daniel as well playing across that half-back line, which feeds into my point about the high half-forwards for the Demons. They're going to have to shut down on these blokes, or at least be mindful. And I think Harms is a super dangerous defensive half-forward because he can kick goals, as can Alex Neil Bull. And they can't allow this to happen. Have a look at Daniel just sitting off here. Now, he is such a creative player. He was the highest rated player last time they played against the Demons. He's a brilliant kick. He can pinpoint passes under pressure, and he's one that desperately needs to be monitored.
I think a huge spot where this game will be won and lost will be the use from the Dogs coming off half-back, going inside 50. If the Demons get it their way, by pressuring the Dogs, yep, high kicks going forward, Lever May chopping it off, giving to their running halfbacks, I think they'll have their way with the Dogs.
And you just mentioned Stephen May there. Is he the obvious one to match up with Aaron Norton?
He's the obvious one. Whether that matchup will happen, I don't know. I think they like him to maybe play on the second tool and have him and Lever being that ability to zone off. But just on those two high half forwards, that's the decision you've got to make as a high half backs, as a high half forward. Do you go into the stoppage and assist, yep, in the contest, or do you sit back shoulder on a Caleb Daniel? So when he gets the ball, the pressure's already there.
And you mentioned the P word, and ultimately that's what's going to decide whether these two tactics work. The whole footy world knows that the Bulldogs roll up, and the whole footy world knows that essentially Melbourne hold back. What will determine which style wins is the pressure, and the number, the magic number, is 200. If they can bring 200 pressure, Melbourne, it can disrupt the Dogs. If the Dogs can cope with 200 pressure, then they're a chance to win.
And okay. Accuracy.
Mm. Accuracy. Mm. Yes. OK. We've spoken a lot about the Ds, it feels like, in this preview so far. Can I ask you about Luke Beveridge and the Bulldogs? I mean, the Bulldogs have won 2 premierships, 1954 and 2016. Yeah. If they are to win one more game, he's a 2-time premiership coach. That elevates him to getting his own statue next to EJ Witten at Witten Oval, surely.
Yeah, it gets him to giant stage.
Yeah, not and just from 7th the first time, 5th the second time.
Well, I don't think anybody's ever done what he's about to do if he does win this. And we looked at this during the week, Kel. It's quite incredible that out of the 7 finals, 8 finals that he's will have to have gone through to get to 2 premierships, he's been favourite in once, and it was against the Bombers a few weeks ago. I mean, this is an incredible performance. It will not only elevate him to the level of Charlie Sutton, probably goes past Charlie Sutton, and EJ, who had an incredible on-field career, but he becomes a giant in the coaching sphere as well, because other guys have coached more flags, and clearly 3, 4, 5 flags, you're a giant. But 2 flags like this, 2 flags where nobody, not anybody in the football world 2 times in a row, has given the Dogs any chance whatsoever, suggests that he's got a hell of a lot going for him other than a bit of luck.
So how important is the start then? You mentioned the late Charlie Sutton, and he had that famous saying, didn't he, before heading out, shop early and avoid the rush boys. 1954, it featured, of course, Sutton, who was the captain coach, and in that game, when we have a look at this old vision. You could watch this stuff all day, couldn't you? It featured Teddy Whitten and Barassi. They played two of the biggest names in VFL history, but the start is so significant.
Yeah, how ironic that saying is, especially in the day and age that we're living in at the moment. Get in and get those toilet papers. But it is. I mean, I've been fortunate enough to work with Bevo, and he is just a marvel. Even to get his side, I mean, they've had a fantastic season, but yet they had a form slump of about 4 weeks. So to get the side out of that form slump after a disappointing loss in round 22 to a position where they're playing off in a grand final again, I feel like Bevo and the Western Bulldogs and the coaching staff wouldn't want it any other way.
Yep. All right. Well, let's get back out to sunny Perth, because that's where Kath Lochman and Matthew Pavlich are standing by. Pav, we're talking about how significant the start is in a grand final. What's your opinion on that, nailing your chances early in a season decider?
Well, it's grand final day, Kel, so let's reopen some old wounds from 2013 and get emotional, because I think back to that day, and we actually started the game quite well in terms of the way we were playing, but we had 3 points on the board at quarter time, a couple out in the full, and if you think about half time, it was 1-6 and about 3 or 4 out in the full. So we didn't shop early. We had to come late against Geordie's team and the Hawks, and we eventually got our way back into the game, but you avoid having to chase the game and sort of take a few more risks if you take those opportunities. And both teams are just out here at the moment, Kath, doing their warm-up and trying to practice that moment of executing in front of goal.
Yeah.
They're out there at the moment just taking it all in, but no doubt making sure they can execute, as I said.
It's really starting to build here. I think the last time we crossed to you guys, there was probably only about 20,000 in the stadium. There's probably nearly 40,000 here. We're heading for a sellout of 61,000, and the players are out on the field at the moment warming up. I mean, this is the biggest crowd they've probably witnessed, apart from the Prelude final weekend, of course. But we see fans all taking photos and selfies, the players looking around. We've got the pre-game entertainment stages out and ready. It's go time.
Well, they've been taking it all in. I'm just looking behind, because you can see they're actually just looking around, soaking up the atmosphere. It's a different warm-up, of course. All the pre-game, as you said, paraphernalia and whatnot is out there, but they are just taking a few short kicks, getting used to the conditions. They've gone up one end, which is in bright sunlight, so the Bulldogs started there, maybe thought it was a bit too hot, so they've come down into the shaded end, swapped over to the Demons. But starting early, you talked about it, Kelly, it is absolutely crucial. And whoever does that, my sense on this is if the Bulldogs get off to a flyer, some of those doubts might start to creep in to the Demons. So really important to get off to a good start for Melbourne.
Okay, while we can still hear you guys before it gets too loud and that entertainment ramps up, can I get a tip from both of you?
Well, I think we're both going Melbourne, aren't we? Yeah, we're jumping. Yeah. A lot of Perth people are jumping on the D's bandwagon, and I think we're going to jump on board too. So I've gone Melbourne by 14.
Melbourne by just over 4 goals, 25 points, and maybe a typical one, but Christian Petrucca to hit the scoreboard.
I've got a typical one too, Clayton Oliver for Norm Smith. He's just been so consistent this season, so he seems like a safe bet.
OK, thanks, guys. We'll cross out to you very, very shortly. A quick tip from our panel here, Jared.
I'm going for the Demons by 13 points. The Norm Smith medal, Jack Viney, although I do love a smoky in the Norm Smith, and I'm having $10 on Tom McDonald at 40-1.
OK, I'm going Demons by 16, and I think Stephen May, speak about smoky, Stephen May for the Norm Smith.
30-1, not bad for you.
Yep.
You and I are both Demons by 16 points. I've got Petrucca for my Norm Smith. My smoky will be Christian Salem. Mm.
You're all sheep, the lot of you. I'm on the doggies bandwagon. I've got them for 28 points, and I'm going with Bailey Smith.
28.
I think he'll be Mr. September. Yeah, I think they'll land a few early punches, and the Demons, sorry, Geordie, will be
shop early,
playing catch-up footy. Stick around as we continue to ramp up the build-up here to the 2021 AFL Grand Final. As you can see, the next panel on their way. We're talking Eddie Maguire, we're talking Jonathan Brown, we're talking Nick Rehbold, and a very, very nervous Brad Johnson.
No,
happy grand final night, gents. Enjoy it. Loved and appreciated the insights, and don't forget you can get a full wrap-up of the 2021 AFL Grand Final on Monday night, AFL 360, and then the man next to me, Jared, will be back on the couch. Happy grand final night, everyone.